Greetings to everyone in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Today's worship gives emphasis and sort of a tribute to our fathers. And of course, our Heavenly Father, who is the source of everything and the reason why we are here as His children, to offer ourselves for worship. Let's prepare our hearts to receive the Lord's bountiful blessings while we are inspired by the music, "This Is My Father's World." Our call to worship is found in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 11 and 12. "For you know that we dealt with each of you, encouraging, comforting, and urging you to live lives worthy of God." Altogether, let us worship our God.
Yeah.
Please join me in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, our provider, our maker, and our protector. O Lord, you are worthy of all of our praises. We thank you, dear God, for allowing us to receive the blessings of your presence today, having to overcome distances and physical fellowship, but at the same time, reminded and encouraged in knowing that our God is omniscient, omnipotent, and omnipresent. And so, we are confident that you are with us this afternoon, and we worship you in spirit and in truth. Hallowed be thy name, O Lord. Lord, please accept our love and adoration. We ask for the forgiveness of our iniquities, and we pray that you will always light our way with your words. Lord, we also pray that all people may see your glory through us and come to know you as their living God. Please give us strength and guidance that everything we do be done for your glory forever and ever. O Holy Spirit, we invoke your presence in this afternoon's virtual meeting. From the very start and to the end, glorify yourself and accept our prayers and our praise. For all this we pray in the mighty name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Many things had transpired in the world we live in this past 15 months. And the heaviest one was losing a loved one. And even on this very day, we mourn the loss of a father and our very own church father. How then do we reconcile singing praise to our God? The song says, it is a good thing to give thanks unto the Lord. In sorrows and in grief, it is a good thing. So, with comfort, peace, and joy in our hearts, let's offer our songs of praise.
Think you're like, but I tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. Hardly speak, peace so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me, deeper still as you call. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways.
It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved.
You are perfect in all.
Good afternoon, and to all the fathers out there, a happy Father's Day to you. It is indeed an honor to bring you the message from God's Word this afternoon, and the title of my message is God's Kind of Father, and our text is in the Old Testament book of Genesis, chapter 18, verse 19. If you are asked of a factor that is in nearly every social ill facing America today, what would it be? To me, the answer is father factor. And a lot of people will probably agree with me. I say that because there is a father absence crisis in America. According to the U.S. Census Bureau, 18.3 million children, that is one in four, live without a biological, step, or adoptive father in the home. Research shows when a child is raised in a father absent home, he or she is affected in the following ways. And let me enumerate some to you. The child has five times greater risk of poverty and commit crime. The child is more likely to have behavioral problems. Also, the child has two times greater risk of infant mortality. The child is seven times more likely to become pregnant as a teen. The child is more likely to face abuse and neglect. Also, the child is more likely to abuse drug and alcohol. And the child is two times more likely to suffer obesity. And the child is nine times more likely to drop out of school. And the child, sadly enough, is 20 times more likely to go to prison. And here in America, if you look at other demographics, there are higher rates of incidences. And it's not only confined in America, because in other countries, yeah, they're experiencing similar things. In the Philippines, for example, there in the last past over a decade, there has been a breakdown in family. And the reason may be different because in the Philippines, the so-called migration or OFW phenomenon have actually contributed to the breakdown in families. But nevertheless, let's go to back to our studies. Of all the fathers named in the Bible, Abraham stands out as the kind of father God wants every father to be. Concerning Abraham, God said in Genesis 18, 19, and that is our text, and it says, "For I have chosen him, son, that he will direct his children and his household after him to keep the way of the Lord by doing what is right and just, so that the Lord will bring about for Abraham what he has promised him." You see, Abraham was a man of great faith, obedience, generosity, and prayer. He is truly one of the most outstanding men in the Bible and is worthy of being imitated by all men, especially fathers. From Abraham, we learn what God's kind of father is like. First, God's kind of father is a man with God's call on his life. Little is known about Abraham's early life. We meet him first in Genesis chapter 11, and then in Genesis chapter 12, verse 1, when God called him to leave his homeland, family, and friends to go out to a land God would give him. Abraham responded in faith to God's call without knowing where he was going. God had called Abraham to become the father of the nation, of a nation, Israel. That would be the channel through whom God would bless the world. And Abraham was obedient to that call. What a blessing it is for children to have a father and a wife to have a husband with God's call on his life. When we talk of God calling a man, we usually think of him calling someone to professional ministry. But I am convinced that God's calling rests on every father. It is a calling to raise your children in the way God wants you to. Ephesians 6:4 says, "Fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord." The phrase "bring them up" literally means to rear up to maturity. Every one of us is called by God to raise our children in the way of the Lord. All fathers might not be called to preach or to be a missionary, but all fathers are called to be an emissary of the gospel in their own home. A man in Chicago made it a practice to stop in a bar for a drink or two on his way to work. One morning, as he walked toward the bar in a newly fallen snow, he heard a voice, a small voice behind him saying, "Daddy, I'm following in your footsteps." It was the voice of his young son as he tried to place his feet in his dad's footprints in the snow. The man cried out to the Lord, "Oh God, if my boy is following my steps, by your help, I'll track them in another direction." Fathers, may I remind you that whether you like it or not, your children will be more like you than any other man in the world. We can influence our children for bad or for good. If my tracks lead to sinful behavior, I can bet my children will follow in that behavior. If my tracks lead to godly living, most likely my children will also live godly lives. So we have to be careful where our tracks lead our children. Second, God's kind of father is a man with God's blessing in his life. God greatly blessed faithful Abraham. He made him the leader of a great nation through whom the Savior would come. God also blessed Abraham with Canaan as his and his descendants' homeland. Finally, God blessed Abraham with the promised son, Isaac, in Abraham in Sarah's old age. Remember, Abraham was 100 and Sarah was 90. What a great blessing Isaac inherited to be born in godly Abraham's home and to be raised by a father of such great faith. Abraham responded to the blessing of God by passing those blessings on to his son. Ensign Neil Anderson Scott, the son of a Presbyterian minister in Goldsboro, North Carolina, enlisted in the Navy during World War II. His ship was hit by a Japanese suicide plane during a sea battle. Neil Scott was mortally wounded. As he lay dying, he said, and I quote, "Mates, keep those guns firing," unquote. Then he wrote a letter to his parents that said, and I quote, "To have had you and mother for these 24 years has been all I could ask for in this world," unquote. Oh, what a tribute to his mom and dad. It would be nice if all children could have that kind of parents. Our world would be a better place. Our streets would be safer. Our children would be happier, more secure, and more productive. You see, God's kind of father takes the blessing that God has given him and uses them to bless his own children. Third, God's kind of father is a man with a gracious spirit. In Genesis chapter 13, when a conflict arose between Abraham's herdsmen and Lot's herdsmen over the inadequate supply of water and grass on the mountainside, Abraham graciously offered Lot the choice of territories. Whatever Lot did not choose, Abraham willingly would take. Later in Genesis 21, when conflict arose in the home over Hagar and Ishmael, Abraham exercised a warm, loving, gracious spirit. In spite of very difficult and uncomfortable circumstances, Abraham sought to be kind and generous to all his family. Of all the qualities a godly father ought to have, a gracious spirit ought to be close to the top. Very likely, Isaac learned his gracious, patient spirit from his godly father, Abraham. One evening, a father came home from work to find his boy had been sent to bed for swearing or cussing. The father stormed up the stair, vowing to teach his son a lesson. On the way, he tripped on a step and skinned his shin. When he did, he began to curse loudly and violently. His wife said, and I quote, "You better come down now. He's had enough for his first lesson," unquote. Is that the lesson our children learn from us? Or do they learn the lesson of a gracious, loving, kind, and godly spirit? You see, if we want our children to have a gracious spirit, one way of seeing that accomplished is to give them an example of a gracious spirit in our own lives so that they will have a pattern in which they can follow. In short, we're modeling those positive behaviors. Fourth, God's kind of father is a man of great prayer. What higher wish could children have than to know that their father was holding them up in daily prayer? For me, ever since my two boys were still babies, I have made it a personal practice to pray for my children every day. I pray for their welfare, but more importantly, I pray that they will grow up to be the Christians God intends for them to be. We know that Abraham was a man of prayer. In Genesis chapter 15, his prayer is recorded for us concerning the promised son. In Genesis chapter 17, he prayed for the welfare of his son Ishmael. And then in chapter 18, he prayed about the threat and destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. Yes, Abraham was a man of prayer. A poet has written these beautiful words of a father's prayer. And it goes like this. Dear God, my little boy of three has said his nightly prayer to thee. Before his eyes were closed in sleep, he asked that thou his soul would keep. And I, still kneeling at his bed, my hand upon his tousled head, do ask with deep humility that thou, dear Lord, remember me. Make me, kind Lord, a worthy dad, that I may lead this little lad in pathways ever fair and bright, that I may keep his steps aright. O God, his trust may never be destroyed or even marred by me. So for the simple things he prayed, with childish voice so unafraid, I, trembling, ask the same from thee, dear Lord, kind Lord, remember me. Lastly, God's kind of father is a man of great faith. With all of Abraham's great traits, the trait the Bible singles out for special praise is his faith. The writer of Hebrews emphasizes this when he writes in Hebrews 11:8, says, by faith Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. And then in the following verse, verse 9, it says, by faith he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. And then in verse 10, it says, for he was looking forward to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. And then the following verse, verse 11, it says, by faith, Abraham, even though he was past age and Sarah herself was barren, was enabled to become a father because he considered him faithful who had made the promise. And then in Hebrews 11:17, it says, by faith, Abraham, when God tested him, offered Isaac as a sacrifice. And most importantly, we find in Genesis 15:6 and later repeated in the New Testament, and it says, Abram believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. Abraham placed his faith in a saving relationship with God the Father. What child would not long for a dad who by faith had become a child of God, who was living by faith, and who was attempting to lead his family in a faith walk with God. That child would never have to fear the abuse and neglect many children receive from their father. Instead, the child could be sure of kind and loving treatment. Let me just close our study with this. It is a small wonder that James 2:23 tells us that Abraham was called God's friend. Few men that have lived have stood as tall as he. But most of us fathers could come close to this great man of God if we tried. I know of no heavier responsibility and no greater privilege than to be a father, to help mold a life for God and society. In this great work, we truly need God's help. We need Abraham's gracious spirit, his obedient heart, his great faith, and his devoted prayer life. If we have this, other things will fall into place. If we will weave the threads that were Abraham's life into the fabric of our own, we will be God's kind of fathers. And our children will express the feelings of a little boy who walked one day beside his father. And the little boy said, and I quote, "Papa, when you go to heaven, will you take me with you?" "Why, son?" the father replied. "'Cause I want to go with you," was the child's simple reply. Let's pray. Father, we come before you today, humbled and in awe of your grace and mercy. Lord, we thank you for the way you have designed what the family is supposed to look like and the specific roles for you have ordained for to a mother and a father of how to lead their children. Yet, Lord, through our sinful ways, we have taken what you have made holy and created our own version of today's families. Because of this, our children are suffering. Lord, we pray for the dads right now that are not stepping up to the plate as fathers for whatever reason. Once again, we have allowed the evil one to get into our lives and wreak havoc on what you have said is good. We pray for this man to come to their knees and repent, that they would turn from their ways, you, and come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Father, we pray for the children and the moms who are parenting alone because of this man's decisions. We pray you would step in as a father to the fatherless and a defender of widows in these situations, that their story would be another testimony that nothing is too hard for you, Lord. It is in the wonderful, precious, and matchless name of Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen.
I trust in God wherever I may be, upon the land or on the rolling sea. For come what may, from day to day, my Heavenly Father watches over me. I trust in God. I know He cares for me.
Our sending forth is found in Proverbs chapter 23, verses 22 and 25a. Listen to your father who gave you life. A man who fathers a wise son rejoices in him. Everyone, may your father rejoice.
Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this wonderful Sunday, the time that we spent to celebrate Father's Day. We thank you, Lord, that we have fathers who are ready to sacrifice their time and their lives to help us. And especially you as our Father, we thank you, Lord, that you are most gracious to us. We also pray for Tatay Bob, who recently passed away. We pray for comfort for the family who was bereaved, the family of Yaptanko and Rivera, Panginoon. Comfort them with your Holy Spirit, and may you be able to find meaning, they find meaning on their loss of their Tatay. We thank you, our dear Father, and may you bestow the blessing from the Holy Spirit as we conclude our worship service today. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling, to present you without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, Jesus Christ, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, now and forevermore. Amen.
Jesus Christ, our Lord. give him the glory.